Swantec, the Tomer of which was Archie Thompson. Hello, my name is Brooke Thompson. I'm from the Yurok and Crook tribe in Northern California. My grandfather is Archie Thompson. I'm from the Yurok tribe from the Waltek village. I also want to start by acknowledging the indigenous people's land we're on right now, which is the Tualatin, Multnomah, Chinook, Clackamas-Chinook, and Kalapuya. And I also want to start off, because all of this presentation I expanded to make more about Native American misconceptions, because I felt like it was needed to have a full understanding of Native American water rights issues. And so I want to express that a lot of my viewpoints are only for myself and not generalizing a lot of other Native viewpoints, because we're very vast and have different cultures and understandings. And I'll answer any questions at the end if people can stay. I'm working for BES as a CCOP intern right now. Do I need the microphone? I'm working for BES as a CCOP intern right now in collection services, and I'll be here until December. I'm a civil engineering major at Portland State University. I'm not sure what I want to go into for my master's, but BES is changing my mind a little bit, or structural, maybe. I wanted to start with common misconceptions about Native Americans. These came from things people have asked me at school or in previous workplace experiences. One is derogatory words that not everyone knows is not okay to use. Squaw, there's a lot of roads in Oregon that have the word squaw on them, and a lot of streams and rivers have this word. It's not okay to use. Redskin, which is actually a term used to mean scalp for killing a native, which was a successful enterprise back in the day where people were sent out to kill Native Americans and they'd bring back their scalps as proof that they were killed. Eskimo, this term is offensive now. It's what the proper word is Alaskan Native, and what's more proper is to use the actual person's tribal name. That's most appropriate overall. Like, I prefer the word Native American or Native, but I would prefer to be called Yurok or Crook over that. Injun, savage, Indian giver, these things are all not appropriate in a work environment. Is saying Indian okay? This was a popular term back in the day, quote unquote. But we say a lot on the reservation right now. It's not really okay for other people to say this word though. And it kind of gives off a sense of ignorance, since this was due to a mistake by Columbus that doesn't even really carry over to this part in the Americas. And again, you know, American Indian, Native American, with the tribal name usually being the most appropriate. Do Natives live in teepees? I've actually been asked this one when I was younger due to a lot of film. And so teepees were mainly around the plains area in America, not on the West Coast, and it's not a common thing Natives do to this day. Although some did stay in teepees over the winter at Standing Rock, but it's not a common thing, even though people do have them still. Do Natives get free money from the government? And I get asked this quite a bit at my school environment, which kind of blows my mind, and it's kind of due to a false idea of Native American privilege that we are getting free things from the government when we often aren't. We don't get any government handouts. The most we usually get is government grants for building projects with on a reservation. And actually 28.3% of Native Americans live on below the poverty line versus 15.4% of the overall US population from a survey done in 2014. Are Natives exempt from taxes? This is another common one I hear along with the previous statement. So, no, we are not exempt from taxes. We pay taxes just like everyone else. This kind of comes from a stereotype of Native Americans being lazy, in addition to the idea that there's one law on the reservation where if you work on the reservation and you live on the reservation, then you don't have to pay federal taxes. But, you know, if you work outside the reservation, live on the reservation, or live outside of the reservation and work on the reservation, you still need to pay taxes. Casinos. A lot of people assume all tribes have casinos, and I'm asked if my tribe has a casino a lot. Actually, we just built one 2 years ago, but that's not the point of this. 58% of tribes have no gaming operations at all, which I think comes to a surprise to quite a few people. Oh, and of these gaming operations, a lot of what these gaming revenues have to go to is to improve infrastructure, develop educational opportunities, and provide social programs to its people. This is very different from the NET you might see on TV where stockholders get a lot of the benefit, but no, the proceeds from casinos, even if they do get paid per capita for some people in tribes, most go back into the community to rebuild it. I'll come back to this later, but light-skinned natives and how Indian are you? I get asked this a lot as well, being a light-skinned Native American. And it's also not really an appropriate question in the workplace environment, because you wouldn't go up to like some random person you don't know very well and be like, hey, how white are you? And it's just kind of a awkward conversation that doesn't really need to happen. But what is more appropriate to say is, please tell me about your heritage, because that's taking away the race aspect of it and going more into the person and where you come from and who you are. Next, I want to go to some fun facts. Number of tribes in the U.S. I did a survey 2 years ago at Portland State for one of my social studies classes, and I asked different people how many tribes they thought were in the U.S. Most people picked around 10 to 17. There's actually 562 federally recognized tribes in the United States and Alaska. This also does not include federally, or tribes who are not recognized by the federal government, which includes a lot of my friends, like the Lani people in the San Francisco Bay Area, where they are trying to get federal recognition, but for one reason or not, either the land is too expensive to pay back referendums to them, or such things as that. So this number is actually a lot larger. Even though they were not citizens, over 8,000 Native Americans served during World War I, and 44 served in World War II, which includes my grandfather and the Code Talkers. If you don't know who the Code Talkers are, they're a group of Navajo who pretty much spoke in their own language to translate code back and forth between the United States to ensure that the messengers weren't getting received by Nazi Germany, which actually was a huge part in winning the war. And this was picked up from the Cherokee in Chippewa, who did this in World War I. And actually, Hitler knew about this from World War I and put out anthropologists to study the language in America before World War II broke out. But since there are so many dialects, it was too confusing for them to break. State names are Native American words. I just think this is fun. Alabama, Arizona, Connecticut, Hawaii, Idaho, Illinois, Iowa, Kansas, Kentucky, Massachusetts, Michigan, Minnesota, Mississippi, Missouri, Nebraska, Ohio, Oklahoma, Dakota, Tennessee, Texas, Utah, Wisconsin, and Wyoming. Carlisle Indian School and Pop Warner Football. So I don't know if any of you guys have had kids who were did Pop Warner Football. It's kind of a league in lower standards of football. Youth doesn't. But Pop Warner was a real person who was a coach for the Carlisle Indian School, which was a boarding school, who competed against teams such as the Harvard team. And they actually pioneered a lot of the football techniques we use today. They're called the team that invented football. They invented things such as the forward pass and the overhead spiral, among other trick plays. Even once sewing fake footballs onto their shirts so when they passed balls to each other, the team couldn't tell who the ball was passing. The word powwow, I've heard this used, for example, when I was in a cabin for Concrete Canoe. Another person kept having meetings and just calling them powwows, not actually realizing what a powwow actually was. And so this was a bit frustrating to me because a lot of people don't know the origin of this word and use it very casually. A powwow is actually a North American, Native American ceremony involving feasting, singing, prayer, and dancing. And it's also not kind of a really appropriate word to use in the work environment for a small meeting. Just say, let's have a meeting. Native Americans make up 1.7% of the U.S. population, compared to 1.5% in 2000. And this is, I think, an interesting fact because a lot of people have, I think, an idea that Native Americans are disappearing or going away. but actually our population is increasing. And this is what a powwow looks like, in case any of you have not seen this before. This is a fancy dance. Now we've talked about some history facts. And some more depressing things. Oregon had black exclusion laws. The second one was enacted in September 21st, 1849, which stated African Americans were not allowed to live in Oregon. The preamble to this law addressed a concern that African Americans might intermix with Indians, instilling into their minds feelings of hostility towards the white race. And I wasn't taught this, despite going to parts of elementary school, middle school, and high school in Oregon, which seems like a huge lack of my education as a Native American or just any citizen of the state. And so I'm sure others have had the same. 1800s boarding schools. And so in the 1800s, lots of Natives were taken from their homes and forced to go to boarding schools. This was an era when they had the idea of killing the Indian to save the man. And it was pretty much a cultural genocide where they were forced to leave their homes, go to these schools where their hair was cut, they were forced to speak English, they weren't allowed to speak their own language, practice any of their own beliefs, and pretty much try to have entire cultural erasure, and trained to do low-level jobs such as working as bag boys or working as housekeepers and small things like that. Actually, Oregon Chamala's Indian School is still running, and it's the oldest and longest continuously running Indian boarding school in the country, so I guess the world, but. And their values have changed, and I actually have cousins who go there now, but it just gives a little context into the history and kind of why there's some issues with Natives today, because a lot of our culture was taken away back then, and my grandfather was actually taken to boarding school himself, and he was one of the last Native speakers of our language, but despite going to boarding school. And my mother told me a story that was told to her by him about him being able to go home for Christmas break, and he didn't want to go back. So he tried to hide under his bed, and they bound him. They forcefully pulled him out from under his bed and dragged him back to the school by his legs. And actually, many of the code talkers were in boarding schools themselves, which is kind of insane when you think of these people who helped us win the war, and that the part of them that helped us win, we tried to completely erase. Native Americans received citizenship on June 2nd, 1924. My grandfather was born in 1919, which means when he was born, he was not a US citizen, and neither were his parents. And so this gave the right to vote, which is a huge deal. And actually, many of you know, women were given the right to vote in 1920. And so it kind of puts in perspective how insane it is that Native Americans weren't allowed to vote before women were. Indian Child Welfare Act of 1978. This was important because this accounted for a large removal of children from their homes. And the Welfare Act tried to stop that, giving tribes a jurisdiction over their kids. 25 to 35% of Native American children were put into non-Native households at this time. And the BIA, which is Bureau of Indian Affairs, even paid some states to do this and gave them incentives. And this is kind of like boarding school, where it wasn't seen right to grow up Native American, and a lot of these kids grew up without their culture, which is really detrimental to their identity. And a lot of these homes weren't safe for them. They are used and abused all the times and just not understood. But the Welfare Act helped stop this, but probably at too late of a time than was needed. American Indian Religious Freedom Act was signed on August 11th, 1987. Many aspects of Native American culture and identity were prohibited by law. Access to sacred sites, such as freedom to worship through ceremonial rites, possession of sacred items, were all considered illegal and did not have proper rights to. And so we did not get the right to really religious freedom until the 80s, which I can't even really imagine now, because a lot of our civil rights and rights were done in secret because of this. And that's another reason we have a larger erasure of our culture today. But at least for my tribe, we're still celebrating a lot of our ceremonies now because we were able to practice in secret back then. And even though this might have not seemed so fun, I'm going to go a little more not so fun facts. Things that stunned me when I read them, and things I've only found out in like the last 4 years, especially studying in New Zealand, where I learned about a lot of the Māori, which is indigenous people of the lands, issues, and having a class taught by a Māori professor with a Māori worldview encouraged me to look into my own ethnicity. When was Sacagawea was kidnapped and sold as a slave before she joined Lewis and Clark. That fact's not usually told, despite how much we talk about Lewis and Clark in this part of the world. High school graduation rates. This is from 2014 to 2015. And as you see, American Indians / Alaska Natives have the lowest graduation percent, when the board's 72%, with the nation average being 83%. About 65% earn a high school diploma, compared to 75.2% of the rest of the US population. College graduation rate is also much lower, with 9.3% earning a college degree, compared to the national average of 20.3%. And out of doctorate degrees awarded in the US, 73.5%, which is 24,209, were awarded to white students, while 0.03%, 102, went to natives. This number was actually 0.5% in 1992, and natives are actually the only minority to have the number of PhD graduates decrease in this amount of time, which is a bit heartbreaking. I'm actually going to a conference next month on minorities who have PhDs to learn more about this. Mm. But I want to talk about this with myself slightly, because I was awarded the Gates Millennial Scholarship, which is a scholarship provided by Bill Gates that pretty much pays for my entire education through my PhD, including housing, food, and books. Mm-hmm. So I'm very fortunate to have that, but at the same time, I also experienced a lot of prejudice for having it. I lost one of my best friends in high school because she said there wasn't enough scholarships for middle-class white people, and mm-hmm. I just got it because I was Native American. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people, when I tell them this, even though it's something I want to be proud of, just assume it's because I'm Native American. This scholarship actually, this last year, only had a 0.02% chance of being won, and is awarded to students who demonstrate academic excellence and strong leadership skills. And it's not based on race and ethnicity, actually. But despite this, and the fact that Portland State provides hardly any specific Native American scholarships whatsoever, despite full ride ones, people assume that I'm in school a lot of times because I'm Native American, because I was given a free pass, and don't acknowledge the hardships and the long nights I had to stay studying to get there. In the past 5 years alone, the number of Native Americans incarcerated in federal prisons has increased by 27%. In South Dakota, the state with the fourth highest percentage of Native American residents, 8.5%. Native Americans compose 60% of federal caseloads. Native Americans are incarcerated at a rate 38% times higher than the national average, according to the Bureau of Justice Statistics. Native American youths are 30% more likely than white students to be referred to juvenile court than have charges dropped, according to the National Council on Crime and Delinquency. And this one's important to me because I've had a lot of younger cousins be sent to juvie, and what they really need is people to talk to them and people and teachers to work with them, instead of when they do something wrong to automatically send them to court, which is almost been insane to me, because the statistics for going to juvie once means you're way more likely to end up in prison later in life and less likely to finish school. Also, this is made, a lot of this is caused by implicit bias from teachers who kind of have the idea that, like, from things they've seen on TV, things they've heard, that they punish students of color a little more harshly, even though this isn't their intention. It's just something they do because of images they've been shown and not having actual interactions with a lot of Native American families or a lot of families, minorities. Native Americans are more likely to be killed by police than any other racial group, according to the Center on Juvenile Criminal Justice. This is per capita. Native Americans fall victim to violent crimes at more than double the rate of all other U.S. citizens. 88% of violent crimes committed against Native American women is carried out by non-Native perpetrators. And then I want to take a sec to talk about my uncle. My uncle, I walk, which means rest in peace, Timmy Thompson, was murdered in a hate crime a few months ago. This is difficult because it's like, you know the statistics, but at the same time, this has been happening more regularly, at least for us on my reservation, and to have this person who was a white man come and plan to kill Native Americans on the reservation. My uncle just happened to be the unfortunate one. Fortunately, my cousin Thunder survived, who was also stabbed, and he is being prosecuted and charged with hate crime at the moment. He's going on trial for hate crime this winter. But the fact that it's hard to feel safe on the reservation anymore, and that these have become slightly more likely, because even in the same weekend, another Native woman was shot through her wall and killed as well. But this also comes up with the low percentage of Native Americans with PhD. One of the things I did to get the travel for me to go to the conference next month about minority to have PhD is talking about why Native Americans might have such a low PhD graduation rate. And one of the reasons I found was because Native Americans have to deal with issues like this a lot more at home. And funerals and services isn't like a weekend ordeal. It's something you have to at least spend a week doing, preparing, spending with your family. And a lot of times, at least in my experience, teachers still expect you to be sending work, doing finals, keeping up with the rest of the class consistently, despite maybe not having very good internet access. And like, you can go to the Dean of Student Affairs, but when you're going through something like this, it's difficult to go through all those steps. And this is an uncommon thing between Natives. And a lot of my friends I've had on reservations have to go through this a lot as well and take weeks off of school. And it's hard to jump back in and expect to perform at the rate of other students. So a lot of people end up dropping out. This is a statistic of suicide rates among young adults. Native Americans are at 22.5% when the rest of the population on average is 12.8%. That's almost double. For young Native men, I think it's ages 17 through 25, but don't quote me on that. It's the second most likely way they'll die, while nationally it's the seventh. And this is the actual headline for my tribe last year, where we had to declare a state of emergency because so many Native youth killed themselves. Okay, I want to go on a slightly happier note and talk about me a little bit more now that I kind of have some of the background information out of the way. This is my grandmother and my uncle. They are German, French, Irish, Scandinavian, Scottish, British, a little bit of everything. And then this is my father in the middle here. And he is Yurok and Creek Native American. And then it's me in the middle. My mom is over here. And I kind of just want to show this because going back to the light skin thing, a lot of people address me about it. And it's kind of hard for me to talk about because they don't also realize like what my mom's side of the family looks like. Because a lot of times I get mistaken for not being a part of their family. Mm-hmm. And I'm actually a lot more accepted in my dad's side. One, because the tribe's smaller and people know me. But also because it's a lot about ethnicity and not so much race. It's about how you grew up. If you grew up with your traditions, your rights, your songs, your language, if you grew up respecting elders versus what you look like on the outside. And my mom told me a story about when we went to Chuck E. Cheese when I was younger, and up in Oregon when we first moved here a little after 2000, and how a security guard asked her if, the security guard asked me if that was my mother, because they thought she might just be, you know, stealing a random kid at Chuck E. Cheese or something. But this happens to me multiple times a year, where I'll be out with like my grandmother and friends, and when my grandmother says she's here with her granddaughter, they automatically assume it's the other child and not me. And so I just think this is interesting to point out if you're not from a biracial marriage or relationship, that, you know, biracial kids do exist, and then maybe just like check your assumptions. This is a picture of me on the right with some of my cousins. This is during one of our tribal ceremonies called the brush dance. This is on the mouth of the Klamath River, which is pictured on the left, which is where we do a lot of our fishing. And so, yeah, this is just me and some of my regalia. We have basket hats that are weaved. This dress is made out of buckskin, shells, and bear grass, and lots of dentellium, which is cells that you'll sometimes see me wear. And then I just want to talk a bit about my tribe. So I'm at the very northern tip of California by the coast, and my reservation is a mile on either side of the lower half of the Klamath River. I'm right by the Redwood Forest. If you ever driven down 101 by the Oregon coast, you might have seen David his blue ox. My tribe is about a mile and a half past there. And so you might have driven past it and not even known. This is my tribal emblem, which you also see me probably wear around a lot. But I just want to talk about our major food staples for a second. So acorns are a major source of kind of grain. It's equivalent to like what bread and rice would be to other people. But don't go eating acorns because they're poisonous. You actually have to like dry them for a year, process them, bleach them before they're edible. And so it's a really long process. And then salmon. We eat a lot of salmon. And it's kind of not only a substance food, but it's kind of a cultural thing. Like, we do as a family. You give salmon to your elders first and then to yourself. It's a community activity. Our houses look like this on the bottom. They're made out of redwood planks, and they actually go underground because the ground is insulating. And our houses, like, this is our tribal office, actually kind of looks like one if you look at the bottom part. And so we try to implement cultural aspects into our more modern-day lives. A little bit of the Klamath River history. Human habitation dates to at least 7,000 years ago. The Klamath includes many of the longest free-flowing stretches of river in California. The Yurok control was about 30 miles of the lower Klamath River. Along with the Hoopup and Kuruk, the lower to upper middle to the mid-upper tribes caught salmon from the river using weirs, basket traps, and spears. Now we use gill nets. Gold was discovered in the 1850s, which caused widespread killing. So our part of California was actually not very colonized until the 1850s when the gold rush happened in 49. And this is one of the reasons I went to New Zealand, because actually New Zealand's population had British settlers come over in about the same year, so they're in about the same place of language loss that we are. Mm-hmm. 1860s Wiyot Massacre. So just south of us are the Wiyot people, and the Wiyot people, during the World Renewal Ceremony, which is what we call a high dance, aka like one of our most important ceremonies times a year in the entire year or 2 year period. I would describe it almost to a New Year's. But this is a time of deep prayer, a lot of fasting, being with family. And at nighttime, when the young men who are going out to gather supplies, and only the kids, elderly, and women were in the camp sleeping, many people in the area who were miners or farmers came up and murdered 80 to 250 of them in their weakest moments. And most of them who were murdered were the elders, young children, and women, because the men were out gathering supplies. And this was one of many coordinated attacks that happened at the time around the area. And despite this, no one was prosecuted for these attacks. I'm going to show you a video of what it looks like to gillnet fish. But this thing's slow, so I'm going to try to do it through this other thing. So this is what gillnet fishing looks like. It's speeded up in double time. I'm not actually that quick. But pretty much we put an anchor down, let out a gillnet that's about 50 to 100 feet long. And we just wait at the end of it for, you know, anywhere 6 to 12 hours. And when you see one of the buoys, they're the white things, bob up and down, you know a fish hit it, and then you row your boat over there, and then you flop the fish into the boat. And so this is what I usually do for a majority of my summers. Started when I was really, really young, but I got my commercial fishing license at 12, which is the earliest you're allowed to have one. Some photos of me. This is one of my proudest moments. It's a 32-pound salmon, but it's like almost the size I am. And then this was me 2 years ago. But I want to just give you a better picture of what the Klamath River estuary looks like. The headwaters are in Oregon at Klamath Falls and goes down to where I am on the mouth of the Klamath River. This is what it looks like for our fishing. After we catch them, we either smoke them for the winter in a smokehouse built of redwood. The smokehouse, we use alder and some applewood to smoke the fish over a process of about a week. And then we'll can them usually, or put them in vacuum seals because, you know, modern day. But this is really good. Or for fresh fish, we'll put them on sticks. This is, we either call it salmon barbecue or fish on sticks, where we take redwood sticks and we put salmon chunks on them and put them over coals and cook them over a process of like 2 to 3 hours. And if you ever get a chance, this is absolutely the best way to have salmon. PSU actually does a salmon bake each year. Also a powwow, a plug in the springtime, so look out for that. The Salmon Wars. My family and my uncle specifically was a part of the Salmon Wars. In 1978, the state of California imposed a ban on sports and Indian fishing in the Klamath River estuary. The reason given for this ban was the decline in salmon run, even though the findings of the fishery biologists pointed to habitat degradation from logging and offshore commercial fishing as the cause of the decline. The Salmon War pitted the tribes of Northern California against both the state of California and the Department of Interior, which is the department that's, or the agency that's supposed to be the guardian of the tribes. Federal agents began to assault control over the Indian gillnet fishing, which is what you saw me and my father doing, on the Klamath River. About 20 agents armed with billy clubs grabbed 5 Yurok natives and confiscated their nets and their catch. And the conflict which followed, boats were rammed by federal officers, natives were arrested and jailed by heavily armed agents. And in one instance, a federal agent held a native's head underwater until he was out of air, let him breathe again, and then pushed him under once again. The Hurons called for a temporary truce with the Secretary of the Interior, and when they visited the area, they had a salmon barbecue without realizing the fish they were eating had actually been caught illegally. And so, we were able to get our fishing rights back again, but in some sense it's never ended. Native Americans are often used as an scapegoat throughout history for decline, even though we've been living peacefully with nature for thousands and thousands of years, literally. So if you look at the common denominator, I don't think it's us, but. If you ever get the chance, I'd read the book, The King of Fish, great book by a Washington State author, who talks a lot about this and then kind of salmon history throughout the United States. An agreement was reached in 2009 that called for removal of 4 dams along the river, which was to help restore the salmon run. And this was to try to remove the dams by 2020, which is coming up. And I'm not sure where we really are on the process right now. It seems to be a standstill in a few areas, but hopefully we get them removed. You'll see why in a second. So there are 6 dams on the Klamath River constructed between 1908 and 1962. Coho salmon, where the Coho and Chinook both run on Klamath, are listed as endangered species. The Trinity River, which is the largest tributary on the Klamath, has 90% of its flow diverted to the Sacramento Valley due to their droughts and water needs. 4 hydraulic dams were built by the California Oregon Power Company, PacifiCorp, who has since had their name changed. 2004 renewal application by PacifiCorp for another 50-year federal operating license by the dams did not include any provisions for allowing salmon to return to more than 300 of its former habitat. And so they pretty much asked for renewal, but then were denied by the federal government in 2007 because they said they had to have fish ladders. And pretty much what happened was they looked at the estimate and fish ladders were actually more expensive than keeping the dams operating. So that's one of the reasons they agreed to take the dams down because it's actually more expensive for them. Dams account for 6.8% of total US energy. And I just mentioned this because it's important to look at when you see things about how well the US is doing with renewable energy. A lot of that time it includes hydroelectric power, which often has other issues that, again, you'll see in a second, at least for me and my tribe. This is what Iron Gate looks like. Iron Gate Dam is the lowest and largest dam on the Klamath River. It's a gravity dam. The remaining water, this is a quote by Pacific Coast Federation Fishermen's Association, by the way. The remaining water left in the river, whatever the project is willing to release from Iron Gate Dam, is so little in volume, so hot, and so laced with pesticides and nitrates from agricultural wastewater that is often fatal for salmon as much as 100 miles downriver. And this is what signs look like that have been put up along the river. I used to see these signs when I was younger and not think they were pertaining to the Klamath River because I was confused on how this river I spent all my time in, this river we fish in and we're expected to fish in, and this river that sustained my tribe, my family for thousands of years could be considered toxic. And the fact that like we can't have kids, dogs, we're supposed to have contact with the water is insane to me, especially when they expect you to be fishing in this water as well. And there's not a lot of public restrooms or anything to rinse your hands and arms off with as well. So these are kind of like unrealistic expectations. And I've had friends and family get sick from this water. Blue-green algae is really nasty. If you've ever smelt it, smells just like a wrong pile of fish. And I know because I'm around a lot of fish, but it's just like the grossest thing. And it gets all over your boat, gets over your motor, gets over your nets. And it's carcinogenic and eats a lot of the oxygen out of the river, which is even worse for salmon populations because they need that dissolved oxygen to live. Fish and dams. Water from the Klamath is used for irrigated agriculture, which was temporarily halted in 2001 to protect endangered salmon during a severe drought. But Vice President Dick Cheney personally intervened to ensure, thank you, water to the agricultural industry rather than to environmental flow. Despite the fact that Klamath River area tribes have had treaty rights that predate the settlement of the farmers. And actually treaty rights in the Constitution are considered the law of the land and above the Constitution in some places. And so we had legal standing in this place and it was just completely ignored. The Klamath River system had the largest fish die-off ever recorded in 2002. High water temperatures allowed for gill rot disease to kill at least 35,000 salmon in September 2002 before they could reproduce. This number is much lower than what we actually believe it was and what we counted, but this was the federal number released, so it's the one we're using. This is a bit of what it looked like. Just salmon lining the shores. And my mom actually was there with me when this happened when I was 7 years old. And just remember how horrible it was to see the shores lined with dead fish. Not only the fact that we couldn't catch them, but other animals couldn't properly eat them, that they didn't get their chance to respawn, and the fact like a lot of their gene lines ended there, and we've never really recovered from this. And also just knowing like these salmon that my family and my tribe have been taking care of for hundreds, if not thousands of years, have all been killed in just such a short amount of time. This is what gill rot looks like on the bottom right. And it obviously spreads faster due to the warm water temperatures. Again, with the not being able to recover, we've had fishing every year. And 3 years ago, fishing season was only open for about 12 hours when it's usually open for about 3 months. And these last 2 years, we've had no fishing season whatsoever due to the low number count of salmon, which was a lot of the income for a lot of tribes along the Klamath River. And so sometimes like means the difference between like a good Christmas and not. Because this is a lot of income, this is a lot of our food source, this is a lot of our tradition and a lot of our culture.
Question?
Yeah.
So the on stream season is closed, but how about offshore? Was it still open?
Parts of the ocean fishing is open, and sometimes the fish, the commercial, not commercial fishing, but sports fishing is open, so people can catch with lines at points. So it's actually open right now for sports fishing, but not for native fishing or even subsistence fishing, which means just fishing for yourself and your family. And then I wanted to transition into a little bit of my activism work and my family's. So this is a great photo, shout out. It's my cousin Jackie's work, and it's kind of displaying different tribes right now who are, or different groups of indigenous people who are having struggles with oil pipelines. Mm. This is a bit of what Standing Rock looked like. Some of these are my photos, some of these are my friend's photos. And Standing Rock, if you don't know, it kind of started in April of last year and continued throughout the year, only ending recently, but not truly ending because there's still a legal battle that's being fought. But pretty much what happened was there is a pipeline that's being built, a really, really long pipeline that's being built for oil that went through the Missouri River. And while being built, it went through some native lands who had treaty right over, where the Sioux and other tribes had treaty right over, and went through possible archaeologically significant sites, and kind of just disrespected that and went completely over. And the tribe, who was joined by many other tribes and people, stood up against this saying, you can't go through our water supply because if this pipeline fails, it's going to poison all our water. And so when I was there, there's about 2,000 Native Americans who were there as well. And I was there for 2 weeks in last September, coming back the day before school started. Mm. And I actually got up there because I went to different rallies in Portland and asked if anyone was planning on going up there and found a ride with someone. Mm. And I found a ride with someone from Nike, so I traveled almost over 2,000 miles with a bunch of people I didn't know to a place I didn't know, where I didn't know if I was going to know anyone there or what the situation was even for showering or restrooms, to try and support these people in any way I could, because I wanted to show my support for them with their water rights and Native American activism and resiliency, but also to hear other people's stories about their water issues and to tell them about ours. But this is kind of what it looked like on the more intense days. People were shot with pepper spray. Just a reminder, everyone here was completely peaceful. There was no weapons, no alcohol, no drugs allowed within the camp whatsoever. This is what the camp normally looked like. You can see how far the tents go. And actually, it took me 3 days to find my cousin who was there because it was such a large camp. And there's no internet there, except on a hill that we call Facebook Hill, where if you walk to the top, you can get a little bit of phone service. But you only also don't have a place to charge your phone, at least when I was there. So if you had to like turn your phone on for like 15 minutes a day, raise it up, send your text messages, and then go back down. But it was really intense. I mean, like, coming up to armed guards who had guns and who had weapons in their hands, when everyone else is peaceful and nonviolent, is really difficult. Just some more photos to try to get an understanding of what it looked like. I mean, when I first went there, there was someone with our armed guard asking where we were going, who we were. And that was scary for me. But I also did this kind of once before when I went to Sacramento, and I will talk about that in a second. But anyways, this was a day where protectors, we don't like to be called protesters, we like to be called protectors because we're protecting the water, not protesting a certain entity, were sprayed by water cannons in sub-freezing temperatures. And, you know, this can cause hypothermia. There wasn't, like, warm houses for us to go to. We were camping. And so a lot of my friends were in this instance. I wasn't. But this was traumatic to a lot of people. Flashbangs were set off. Again, pepper spray. And a lot of people have PTSD from this event that happened last summer and throughout the winter. This girl was shot at point range blank with rubber bullets, which are lethal at point range blank. And she almost lost her arm. I have known someone to be blinded as well. Just some photos that I felt like were good articulation. But this is what the rest of the camp looked like when we weren't having altercations. This was very peaceful most of the time, especially when I was there, where I helped mainly set up food storage. I cooked for the main camp, helped set up food storage for the main camp, and also helped for the Hoopa River Valley camp, which was everyone kind of from my area who were natives, to help take pressure off the main camp. So I cooked for 50 to 100 people for breakfast, lunch, and dinner for multiple days. So if you need catering, I can also do that. This is one of my photos, but it was just beautiful. You can see people who are actually put up teepees, live in them throughout the winter. And they can actually put wood stoves in them, which is really cool. And they can be quite warm. They're almost they are a lot better than tents, actually. And it's cool. This is my first time seeing a teepee in real life. Some of what the resiliency looked like on days, again, that there weren't as much violent altercations. There was a lot of stands and rallies that were happening there. This is what a few of them looked like. And I think this is really great because although what happened is absolutely horrible, and a lot of people have PTSD from it, and I feel like I'm not as authorized to talk about that because I wasn't there when a lot of those most violent events happened. But just seeing, like, different tribes and communities come together who didn't have a lot of connection to each other initially was really inspiring and hopeful to me. It was a lot of helping one another. This is actually from Portland at one of the rallies we've had here. And just the fact that it was a lot of people coming together to help each other, a lot of different races, ethnicities, nations. And even people from New Zealand that I knew flew over just to support Standing Rock. And it's a shame that wasn't more covered by the media. And a lot of these, actually all these photos are taken from my friend Joel, which I want to talk about for a second. So I was put on the board of a nonprofit over this summer called Frontline Wellness. And one of the things we're doing that came out of Standing Rock was to try to provide medical care to pretty much protests and rallies that have humanitarian efforts to provide organized medical care to make sure that if something violent does happen, that we don't look at the size and we make sure people are treated. Because he mainly worked at the medical camp, and actually he was one of the people who came up with me and knew the person who was driving, and I accidentally got him stranded there along with myself. That's a different story if you want to ask me, but out of that came this organization that we've started. And here's some photos of me. This is one of my photos from Standing Rock. My cousin Jackie, who did the photo you saw, and we'll see at the end. And me at a protest in Sacramento when I was 18, and I got in the bus, even though my grandmother told me not to. I got in the bus at 6 a.m. in the morning with a lot of other natives to go down to Sacramento, which I've never been to before, and stood up against some people who had guns at a federal agency to ask for emergency flows to be released for our salmon to make sure we didn't have a fish kill that was like what happened in 2002. And this is scary for me because I'm not, despite being up here, I'm not super outgoing as a person. I'm trying to be more. But the fact that these salmon mean so much to me and my people, that I'm willing to do this, and I think was a predecessor to going to Standing Rock. And just one interesting thing, here's another picture from the Sacramento one, is that we applied for permits to protest there months earlier, but we were denied multiple times. And so the person who was organizing the rally pretty much said, we're gonna go anyways. But I think that's just interesting that they denied us the permits, despite us trying to go through the legal way. Here's me speaking at a rally in Portland after coming back from Standing Rock to share some of my stories and to talk about salmon. Here's me and my friend AJ, who's Karuk, who's one of my other tribes and is from near where I live. And we were both sent by our tribes to go to the Elwha River dam removal to see what it was like there and the effect it had on salmon population, things they could have done better to bring back to our tribes and talk about. This is me at Standing Rock with one of my dad's friends, Snidge. He actually found me because I was walking around in the food line and he saw I had deer horn jewelry on. And because he recognized it's from our area, he was like, oh, you must be from Klamath River. And I was like, yeah. And he's like, who's your family? I was like, oh, my dad's Willie Thompson. Willie Thompson, he's my friend. So you might need to go over to his camp at nighttime. And that's where I actually found my cousin who I was looking for. But it's kind of crazy, like you can travel 2,100 miles and feel more at home than you do at times, like in my own institution and even in Portland a lot of times. And here's me tabling for ACES, shout out for ACES, which is the American Indian Science and Engineering Society. I'm gonna continue running for national representative next year for students. And the society is to increase Native students in STEM. And I include this photo because I think education is a form of resiliency. And I just want to point out, we're almost done, that Monday, October 10th is Columbus Day. But really, it's Indigenous Peoples Day in Portland as 2015. Portland State has an event as well, which you can talk to this guy in the blue shirt about if you want to go to. Berkeley changed Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day in 1992. Seattle, Minnesota changed it in 2014. And Portland has the 9th largest Native population, which is pretty impressive, so I wanted to point it out. Yeah, but that's pretty much my story that I have time for today. Thank you for giving me the platform. And if anyone doesn't have time, they can always email me, find me on the city email, I'm sure. Find me on LinkedIn there too. Or my website, which is brookmthompson.com, where I have other events I've done. But I want to know if anyone had any questions about the American misconceptions, my tribe, or fishing.
Is the salmon population recovering at all? I know they just had a recent drought. It was devastating. I don't know if the rains helped from 2016.
Not for us. Salmon have a 7-year regenerative state, so they go out to the river. They go out to the ocean for multiple years and come back.
Yeah.
So 1 year doesn't make a difference. You have to look at the future lifestyles and the future and how this is going to affect 7 years from now, which is kind of how we think about things in general. All our actions, we think about how it affects 7 generations from now and how it affects your grandchildren and your great-great-grandchildren and not just ourselves in the moment. So it might help a little bit, but even if it does, it's not going to be a long-term solution by any means. Going once? Yeah?
The Elwha, have we seen recovery on the Elwha River?
Elwha was taken down a little less than 10 years ago, so actually salmon population declined after dam removal due to the sediments trapped behind dams. And because of that, it kills a lot of the vegetation due to the lack of sunlight, which makes it harder for microinvertebrates to survive, which makes it harder for salmon fry to eat. And because of that, until all the sand is pushed out, which takes a few years, the salmon population continues to decline. So we haven't seen it revive yet. It hasn't taken enough time. But we have seen salmon respawn up past where the dam was as soon as a year after it was removed, which is good. And there's a lamprey explosion that happened. And I love eating lamprey. It's like a eel type of thing. And there has been a larger species diversity there since the dam has been removed. But again, it hasn't been long enough to see the salmon population recover.
Thank you.
Thank you.